we have RFA in iCQ, and it's sort of an objective value that we can trust for clinical decisions. It's been around for many years. It's widely used, but still there are many clinicians that are working strictly from subjective measures. Why is that, you think?
That's a good question. I think, you know, there's many clinicians out there that haven't been exposed to iSQ. Where do our clinicians get their education? What pathways, and what are they subject to, content-wise? So part of it is, I think there's clinicians, like I just said, that aren't aware of it, and then the clinicians that are choose to take other paths in assessing the health of their implants. And, you know, it's our mission as educators that do research and have clinical practices within universities to help disseminate knowledge. And I'm part of organizations that work worldwide to disseminate knowledge. And when it's validated and there's evidence behind it, it's something that we, you know, we try to showcase and use for the betterment of our patients at the end of the day. But, you know, Kyle hit on something. Actually, Stephen and Tara, when it comes to treating patients today, and you know, I remember seeing some presentations in the past where we have open contacts, tooth movement that occurs adjacent to implants over time, and it just like hits us right in the gut because we really want to provide the best for our patients, and when there's change over time, it can bother us. But I try to flip it. There is an informed consent that we need to do in educating our patients, but also quality of life during that phase of treatment. I have patients that come in that I see discrepancies in mucosal margin to gingival margins and open contacts, and the patients don't even know. They have no idea. They're smiling and they love their implant. I'm pointing out that there's some issues here.
You're taking pictures for your lecture, right?
Yeah,
Showing what happened, what went wrong, and they're like, "I love you, doc. Looks great."
exactly. So sometimes as dentists, you know, we get this tunnel vision right into the mouth, and we see every detail, and our patients don't. So we have to assess quality of life. Circling back to my presentation and the advantages of getting iSQ values over time is I'm in a practice where we have residents that are graduating annually. We have a high volume of patients, and I'm the one constant. You know, these patients come back for follow-ups, and I'm the one that's still there. And anything I can do in my armamentarium to be able to track the health of implants over time, I will use, and that's where the iSQ measurements have helped us, not only in tracking this, but also educating our students and residents on implant stability and how it is affected or can be affected over time.